Hello, this is Keaton, and today I'm going to demonstrate generic collections and passing a list as an argument. So to start, I have a class with a main method, and the first thing we're going to need is something to fill our list with. And in Java, lists can only contain reference types, so we'll use strings. I'm going to make an array of strings just to make it easy to declare them all, and we'll name it strings. Can use the array initializer and fill it with our strings. And the reason why I'm using an array is it just makes a list easier to create, but I'll show you that in just a second. Okay. Then we can just close it with the curly brace and your semicolon. So now that we have all our strings in an array, we need to create a list. And to do that, I'm going to declare a list. And you need to put the type it contains inside angle brackets. And give it a name. Words sounds good. And it's a good idea whenever you have lists or arrays that contain multiple items to keep it plural, just so you remember later. Now we need to instantiate it. But list is an interface type, so it can't be instantiated. So we'll need to use one of list's subclasses that can. And ArrayList is one of those. We'll use the angle brackets again, but here you don't have to put the type because the compiler can infer it from its use right here. So now we have some red underlines here, and the problem is that we haven't yet imported our ArrayList or our list. So now we have an empty list, but we'd like to fill it with strings. And we have an array of strings right here. The ArrayList can be constructed with another collection, but what we have is an array. So it would be nice if we could turn that array into a collection. And with the Arrays class, we can. It has a static method called asList that we can pass in an array, and it will return a view of that array as a collection. And we can use that to construct our array list. So you might have noticed that here I used a list and created it as an array list. So why did I do that? Why not just make this one an array list too? It's a good idea to keep your code as adaptable and ready for change as possible. And that's what this does. Now, if later on I decide that this actually needs to be a linked list or a stack, all of the code that uses words as a list won't have to change. And as long as you don't need any of the functionality that's specific to an array list or whatever type it's actually created as, a list will work just the same. So now that I have my list and it's filled with words, I'd like to do something with it. And whenever you're thinking about adding new functionality, it's often a good idea to add it in a new method. So I'll declare a private method, and it needs to be static so we can use it in our static main method. And I think I'll make one that can take a word and count how many times it occurs in our list. So the count it returns would be an integer. And we'd give it a descriptive name, which word count makes sense to me. And it will need to take a list as one parameter that we're going to search. So you do that just like you do any other parameter, declare its type, and in the angle brackets, you need to say what the list contains, which in our case it's a string, and give it a name. And then we'll want one more parameter. That is the word we're searching for. It's also a string, and just name it word. Now that we've got the method header down, we can add the body. And we'll want a local variable to store our count and initialize it to 0. And now we need to look through the list and compare each word we get with the word we're searching for. So a good way to do that would be an enhanced for loop. So I need to declare the type of the element, which it'll be string because our list is full of strings. And then the list that we're looping through, which it's the word list from our parameters. Now we can decide what we're going to do in our for loop, and each time we get a word from our word list, which is now the element, we want to compare it to the word we're searching for. So we'll take our element, and we can use the strings equals method. And then compare that to our word parameter. And if the element we're currently on passes this test, then we can increment our count. And once we're done searching through the list, then we should return our count. And that should tell us how many times we found the word we're searching for. Now that I've finished my word count method, I want to use it on my list. So I'll go back up here in the main method, and I'd like to see the output, so I'll put it in a print statement. And I'll use a printf just to make it easier to format my output. And I'll label my output with the method that I'm calling so I can keep track of what I did. And we'll call it with quit this time. And we need the format specifier for integer, since that's what our word count method will return. And then we'll give it a new line just to make it look nice. And now we need to give it the argument that will replace the %d, which is our word count method. Use control space just for things that have already been written to find them quickly. And we can pass it our words list and the word we want to search for, which in this case is quit. And finish it off with a semicolon. Now, when we run this, it should return the statement here with the number of times quit appears in our list. So let's try it. And it tells us that quit appears once, which we look at the strings that our word list contains, and it's only there once. So now I'm going to try it again. And I'll make another print statement. I'll use a printf again. And I'm going to just copy my formatted output to make my life easier. And we need the argument that will replace our %d, which is the word count method, and we passed our list called words as an argument. And the word we want to search for. So let's search for never this time. And change it here so we know what we did. Now I think never appears twice here, so let's see what it says. And it tells us that never appears in words twice, which is what we expect.